Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 7 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, we have an awesome interview from Mr. Rob Zaleski, better known as Rob Z Online. At the time of our interview, he was transitioning into his next opportunity, but previously, he was the marketing manager for Marketing Profs, where he oversaw everything social media for them, with the exception of Twitter, which belongs squarely to Ann Hanley. But in his role as marketing manager, he did get to work with Ann Hanley, and I don't know about y'all, but I would crawl over broken glass for an opportunity like that. Plus, in his role, he also got to be involved in the Marketing Profs annual B2B forum, where he rubbed elbows with some of the biggest names in the industry. Plus, just his journey of how he landed that gig in the first place is an inspiration, and we'll get into that in a little bit later. So, without further ado, let's get into our interview with Mr. Rob Z. All right, thanks so much for joining me. I am joined by none other than Mr. Rob Z. Rob is what you call the genuine article. He was previously with Marketing Profs, where he worked remotely as a marketing manager and handled all things social media, except Twitter, of course, because, you know, that belongs firmly to Ann Hanley. And we're going to talk today about his experiences, his journey as someone who's been through it, does it professionally, and can give you that firsthand advice that you can't get anywhere else. So, Rob, thanks so much for joining me.
Absolutely. Super happy to be here. I'm really excited about this new podcast that you're launching. I'm pretty excited to see how this goes and talk a little bit about marketing, kind of nerd out here a little bit.
Absolutely. We're going to have a great time. So the road to professional digital marketing tends to be a winding one. So tell us that story. Give us your journey. When did you first get bit by the digital marketing bug? And when did you first become enchanted with marketing?
Yeah, it's kind of a funny story, actually. I didn't get a degree in marketing. I actually got a degree in media studies, and I found it pretty fascinating because what media studies looks at is the way in which media affects our behavior. And various forms of media throughout history have had differing effects, and you know, in the last few decades, we've seen just this massive change in the amount of information we have available to us, whether that's good, bad, or ugly. And so I found all that kind of stuff very fascinating. I had a great senior year. And my first job out of college then was with a direct marketing agency. And I was actually just working account management for that. But during that time, which was in 2009, 2010, I got bit by the social media bug. And I was just so excited about the things that were happening. You know, Twitter was really coming out on its own, and Facebook was starting to take over everything. And, you know, a lot of businesses started then to adopt social media marketing, at least in the beginning phases. And working for this very small local business that was a direct marketing company, I kept trying to get them on board. It's like, look, we got to start looking at this as an opportunity to spread our ability to work with our clients. And they just kept dragging their feet and kept dragging their feet. And finally, the girl I was dating at the time was going to grad school at the University of Texas at Austin, and I was living in Champaign at the time. And so I decided it was time for a change. And so I started looking for jobs down in Austin that were based on social media marketing. And I ended up working at a startup where I was doing community management and content writing and reputation management. And that really drove me into the foray of the more marketing side as opposed to just the social media side. And then there's a whole other story I wrote a blog post about how I went from that job to working at Marketing Profs, and it was kind of the perfect networking story. I don't know if we want to get into it.
Tell us.
Okay. So it was kind of cool. I was following Mark Schaefer's blog, Businesses Grow, and just, you know, doing what you normally do, commenting on his blog, sharing his articles, you know, reaching out and saying, hey, I love this piece, you know. And when he wrote the book Born to Blog with Stanford Smith, they had a contest where he said, email me if you would like to win a copy of this book and tell me why you deserve a free copy of it. So, of course, I was super excited. I was just getting into blogging at the time, so I emailed him. Didn't expect a response. I figured it was probably just a dump mail that he had a bunch of stuff going to. But he actually responded literally that same day, which totally blew me away. And we actually went back and forth a few times, and he saw that I was living in Austin, Texas. And this was in, I believe, February. And so South by Southwest happens here in March. And he said, hey, I'm going to be down there for South by. You know, I usually like to get a few people together for dinner and drinks, have some conversation, nothing too serious, just kind of casual. You're welcome to join us if you want. And I'm like freaking out all of a sudden. You know, I'm like, right. Yes, please. And so I did. And actually, that was where I first met Carrie O'Shea Gorgone, who runs the Marketing Profs podcast and does some of the instructional design stuff for them. And I also met some other really great marketers here in Austin. So it was a great opportunity. Didn't really expect anything more from it, except for the fact that it was a great chance to meet some cool people. So fast forward to the next year, he was actually going to be speaking at South by Southwest on the topic of content shock, which was, you know, one of his biggest topics that he's probably ever written about. And by that time, he and I were Facebook friends, so I congratulated him on Facebook, said, hey, you know, I can't afford a pass this year, but let me know how it goes, because I think this is going to be huge. Well, funny thing is a lot of speakers get day passes, and he asked me if I wanted to use his day pass to come and see his talk that morning. And of course, again, I'm like freaking out. Yes, totally.
Exactly.
I had a whole itinerary of things I wanted to do. I was like, I'm going to hit this session. I'm going to go do this. And again, Carrie was there as well. She was there kind of representing Marketing Profs. And so I went up to talk to him after his session was over, which was fantastic. And I ran into her and Dave Cutler. And we got into talking a little bit while we were waiting for Mark to finish up with some other people. And she said, hey, you know, Dave and I are going to be going around checking out some of these other sessions. Do you want to join us? And I immediately threw my itinerary out, and I was like, yep. Mm-hmm. So I spent the whole day with them just chatting it up, just genuinely having a good time. Really enjoyed spending the day with Carrie. And towards the end of the day, we kind of both went our separate ways because there's a couple of things separately we wanted to check out. And then, lo and behold, a few months later, I get an email from her and says, hey, this position opened up at Marketing Profs, and I thought you might be really great. Would you like me to make you the introduction? And again, freaking out, I was like, yes. And I didn't think I was going to get the job because, you know, Marketing Profs was this company that I followed, and it was like my source of information. I never thought I was going to be able to work there. And throughout the entire process, I was just looking at it as great networking opportunity, get to know some of these people behind the scenes at Marketing Profs. And I slowly and gradually went from, I'm never going to get a job here. I'm probably not going to get a job here. Maybe I'm going to get a job here. Holy cow, they're offering me a job here.
Right.
And then, you know, spent the last 2.5 years almost working with Marketing Profs, doing marketing management and social media management, and helping to maintain and grow the membership there. And, you know, working directly for Ann Hanley and the VP of marketing, who's Sharon Hudson, both of which I can say have been two of the best bosses I've ever had in my life. Super supportive, always interested in helping me not only grow within the company, but grow for the time when I would come to leave the company. It's a great place to work. And yeah, it was kind of a magical experience. But the whole time, I wasn't, you know, nudging elbows and saying, like, hey, can you get me a job at Marketing Profs? Or, you know, not trying to get anything out of it. I was just genuinely happy to be spending time with these other people who geeked out about the same things that I did. Mm-hmm. And I think that actually really made the difference, is that I wasn't trying to get something out of them. I was just happy to be hanging out with them.
Really quick, and then we'll jump back into the interview. I knew all of this prior to interviewing Rob because I'm familiar with his journey, because I follow him online and I research all of my guests. And in my mind, I associate Rob Zaleski with Mark Schaefer just because of, you know, giving him that day pass South by Southwest. So when we got started, I kept calling Rob Mark because of that mental association. And we had to redo it like 4 or 5 times before we actually got into it. And so I'll play that blooper reel for you real quick, and then we'll hop back in. All right, I am joined by none other than Mr. Mark Z. Mark is a... You're Mark. I'm thinking about Mark Schaefer. No, because you went to South by South, because Southwest and Mark Schaefer, the whole thing. Anyway, okay, sorry.
Right.
You're not Mark Schaefer.
There's one for the outtake reel.
Yeah, I might put this on the end of the episode, actually.
I love it.
But yeah, you don't look anything like Mark Schaefer. Okay, let's try this again. Absolutely. I love that so much. And I just love the way it organically unfolded, because as I tell people all the time, I'm biased when it comes to digital marketing education, but I'm not bougie. Like, it's not my position that everybody has to take the same path that I did. And so I absolutely love the way that your journey unfolded and how it just really organically played itself out. So thanks so much for sharing that with us. So When was the honeymoon over for you? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when was it, you know, when was the newness over and it's like, crap, like this is a real thing and this is the actual job and I have to do this for 10 hours a day?
Well, I mean, I think once you really start, I think what kind of takes the shiny veneer away is when you really have to start adding those KPIs and those goals that you have to hit. And it's kind of one of those things where a hobby becomes a job. And you have to be cautious because when it's no longer a hobby, you still have to try to maintain that investment and that interest and that joy in doing it. Because if you turn it into a slog, you're going to become disenfranchised with it.
Right.
So I think that is important, is to always be curious about it, always be interested. There's so much changing, and which is why I think it's super important to always have a mindset of continuously learning in marketing, because if you stop learning, you're going to fall behind completely.
Right.
And as long as you maintain that curiosity and that wonder and always thinking, I can be better, I can improve, I can do more with this, I think that's the way to keep yourself from becoming disillusioned by it, because it's a lot, you know. I mean, there's always new technologies coming out and there's always new approaches and, you know, disruptions are constantly happening in the industry. And if you're not willing to roll those punches and be able to adjust your course, then you're going to become completely disillusioned by it, because you're trying to do the same old thing you've always done, and you just can't do that now in marketing.
Absolutely. And that's really sage advice, especially when you're talking about social media marketing, because that's, you know, the shiny buzzword. But it's like, do you have any idea how many platforms there are and how much time that's going to take? Like,
and how vastly different they are.
Exactly. Like, you're signing up for 16 hours a day and you don't even know it. So, yeah.
And I think that's where a lot of marketers kind of get stuck in a rut, is because they try to do something on one platform and just try to do the same thing across all platforms. You know, what's the type of messaging and imagery that's going to work on Twitter is not necessarily going to work on Facebook. And it's absolutely not going to work if you start going into Snapchat, for example. Exactly. I mean, you have to really take each platform and figure out, why do people go here? What do they get out of it? And how can I add to that without feeling intrusive?
Right, absolutely. So, if you had a time machine and you can go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum, I watch Doctor Who, if you can't
right.
tell. Got your own little TARDIS. What would be the top three things that you would tell yourself to help prepare for your career?
I would try to get in on some of these websites earlier than I did. There are some that I got in slightly early, but I didn't start experimenting with them early enough. And I think that when you get somebody who starts experimenting early on a platform, they then become kind of those authorities on that platform, because they've been the ones who've seen all the iterations of the technology, and they've been playing with it and trying things out, seeing what works, seeing what doesn't. So, you know, rather than holding off to see if something is going to take flight, or holding off to make sure that you fully understand a platform, just being able to dive in and really start just kicking the tires and get a feel for what is going on there. And you actually can help shape the direction that ends up going. And, you know, it may end up being an occasional waste of time. Sometimes you may jump in on something and then 6 months later, there's nobody there. But as long as you treat it as a learning experience, that's something I would have done a lot earlier, you know, especially with Twitter and Facebook. It took me a while, actually. I was a MySpace holdout for a while, actually.
Yeah, it was a spot. I mean, it really was. People forget about MySpace, but it was jumping back in the day, though.
Yeah. So that would be my first one. My second one would be to read more early on. There's a plethora of amazing books out there right now, and you know, everybody, of course, will have one to five that they'll recommend to you. But there are also some that just keep popping up constantly. And now it's like I'm so entrenched in it that it's hard to find time, because I'm a very slow reader. That's one of my biggest pet peeves about myself, is it takes me forever to get through a book.
You're not alone. You are not alone.
Good to know. So yeah, then that's, you know, that becomes a struggle. I mean, I've probably got 15 books on my bookshelf that I've either purchased or picked up at a conference or been, you know, had someone send me early, and none of them have I've finished. I mean, I've gone partway through them, and some of them are amazingly really well written books. I just, you know, I start reading them and then life gets in the way.
Right.
So that's something I would try to do is while I had a little bit more free time and while I had that initial curiosity, I wish I would have read some more of those really good books and started soaking in some of the tips and information that were given in those books before I was so knee deep in the world of marketing.
So I guess I won't send you a free copy of our book then, because it'll just collect dust on the shelf. No, I'm just playing too. I'll still give you one if you want it.
I love the fact that there are so many good books out there, and I do want to try to dive back into some of them. I need to just make a pile and say, okay, this month I'm going to try to get through this book. This month I'm going to try to get through this book, and just like really prioritize that, and maybe that'll help me slog through all of them.
Right. All right, cool. That's what's up. So before we go to break, one last question. In terms of hard skills, like, you know, Photoshop or being able to code or anything like that, what's the one skill that you would have learned that you didn't?
Definitely coding. I'm a slow reader, slow learner. So I actually once tried to teach myself some HTML, and it just didn't really go very well. So I wish, even early on, like, I mean, when I was in high school, it really wasn't as big of a deal. But in college, I wish I would have maybe taken some basic HTML just to have the groundwork laid for that, and then start learning a little bit more of like CSS or Java or something like that. Because you can do so much with that, and it adds so much more to your marketing skill set, whether it's setting up your own blog and being able to have the understanding of how to make that look good and do all the formatting, or, you know, if you start getting into email marketing and you start wanting to really make your emails interesting and interactive, and you know, having those that background helps a ton in being able to set you up for success in either of those.
Same here. If I could go back and do it all over again, I would absolutely learn how to code, because a marketer I follow, a good friend of mine, Mike King of I Pull Rank, and he works closely with SEO Moz. Well, Moz, they're not SEO anymore. And he speaks, and that was more or less his career trajectory. He knew how to code, and he was able to parlay that into technical SEO. And then from then, he started to speak, and now he has his own digital marketing agency at iPullRank.com. So that's just a really good overall skill to have. So absolutely. So we're going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we are going to grill Mr. Rob Z about his conference experiences and how to get the best out of that, and we will be right back. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry, this is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing, for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. All right, thanks so much for sticking with us. So, Rob, you, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss, or insert any other thought leader you like if you're not with those other two, you're all sitting at a bar after a conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing industry, and how would you brainstorm about correcting that?
The biggest stumbling blocks for people in the marketing industry is listening. So many people want to just push their message out there and want to be the one that's talking and want to be, you know, the one that's controlling the conversation and the dialogue, that so few just listen. Right. And you can learn so much about your audience, about what's happening in the industry, about what direction you should go and what kind of things you should try and test by just listening and paying attention to what's actually happening. But we all get, not all of us, of course, but so many people get caught up in the daily grind or get caught up in trying to control a message and trying to, you know, beat people over the head with a message, that you lose that ability to really listen to what people want, and you try to make them want what you want them to want rather than actually saying, oh, this is what you're looking for. Well, we can actually help with that, and here's how. So I think if everyone takes a step back, whether it's, you know, doing a little bit more social media monitoring, or whether it's directly asking people what kind of things that you can help them with, or what kind of things they're interested in. This works for customers, for marketing industry professionals, if you're trying to work with influencers, if you're trying to activate advocates, which is something I talk about in my most recent webinar. The first thing you have to do is listen, ask questions, pay attention to what people are saying, because that changes the entire game.
Awesome. Tell us a little bit more about influence and advocate marketing, because that's something that I've taken a keen interest in as well. I listened to the Influencer Pros podcast by Convince and Convert. And that's so, what are your thoughts about that hot topic in the industry going forward?
Well, I have an interesting perspective, actually, because I worked for Ann Hanley, and we would have conversations about, you know, the kind of dialogue and outreach that people used. And I've seen the entire gamut of absolutely horrendous approaches to, holy cow, that was so clever approaches. But the ones that are on the higher end of the spectrum have always made it more about the person you're reaching out to than about yourself. So how can I help you in what you're doing? And then hopefully you'll help me. And so I think, and that's the same thing with advocates too. You know, if you want someone to advocate for your brand, you want to listen and find some people who are already passionate about your brand, whether that's monitoring someone who's constantly mentioning your brand or commenting on your blog or a longtime customer, and then actually talk to them and say, hey, you know, what would you like? I actually picked up this really awesome little tidbit from Gunil Chung from Box.com at Influitive's event, AdvoCamp, this past year. And he said, you have to go by S.A.P.S. It's S-A-P-S. Status, access, power, stuff. And that's the four things that people are motivated by to get behind your brand. And you have to figure out what it is of those four that people want. Because some people are totally cool with getting awesome branded swag, or like a, you know, a beanie or a hoodie or a cool pen. Like, some people are totally cool with that and love that stuff. I'm a swag geek. I go to conferences and just dump it all in my bag.
Right.
But other people, you know, they want access to a new community, or they want to feel powerful within the community and feel like they have a little bit more influence. Or they just want to have that status in the industry. And if you can help them achieve that, they're going to be 100% more likely to work with you than if you just say, hey, here's a piece of swag. Will you tell everyone about us? That's not the way it's going to work. Right. So, so few people, and I've seen this because, you know, working at marketing profs, I got a lot of emails too. But between the ones that I got and the ones that Ann also received, so many people just they go for that hard sell immediately and just say, like, hi, how you doing? You never met me before, but will you be an advocate for our brand, or will you be an influencer and do this thing for us?
Right.
And it's just that's far more prevalent than it should be.
Yeah, that just doesn't work. Hey, we just met. Here's a drink. You want to have sex? Like, that you don't right? do that. No.
That's not it's wholly unsatisfying for all parties involved.
Exactly. Just say no, folks. So you have a lot of experience in events, because, you know, I'm a distinct minority in the fact that I have a degree specific to digital marketing, but the vast way that the the majority of the industry educates itself and disseminates best in class practices is through events sort of like Marketing Pros B2B Forum. So what advice, what tips would you get for, you know, trying to figure out which event to go to, how to get the most out of it, and how to make sure that you really get the most bang out of your buck?
Yeah, well, one thing I think also is really interesting to point out here, the every year Marketing Profs and Content Marketing Institute do a study on B2B and B2C content marketing benchmarks. And the last couple of years, both B2B and B2C have said that they get the most value out of in-person events. So I think we're going to see more and more events showing up because marketers and lead gen and sales are seeing more qualified leads and qualified conversations coming out of these live events. I've seen just in the last couple years, a lot of people who used to just sponsor an event are now holding their own events. So, I mean, it's they want to take those reins and really get a hold of that experience for people. Right. But, you know, most people, when they start thinking about going to an event, they immediately look at the schedule and the itinerary and see what's, you know, who's speaking, what are they talking about. And that is an absolutely great place to start, but that shouldn't be the end all be all. And if the event has a hashtag, you should start jumping on that hashtag as early as you can to start really building some relationships with people before you even get to the event. That's one of the things I geek out about so much, having done the B2B forum the last 3 years, is just watching those relationships form. You know, we actually had some people that started a conversation around the hashtag on Twitter, ended up spending the entire conference together, and then are still staying in contact after the conference.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah, and then like within the app, as soon as we released the app, conversation just exploded because people were excited to get going. And you know, so many people were, they already knew each other before they even met in person. So by the time they met in person, they were ready to just rock and roll. And networking is so much easier when you kind of have a buddy or you know, a few buddies, rather than feeling alone in a big room. Right. So if you can start setting those relationships ahead of time, when you get to the event, you're already going to feel so much more comfortable. And then that's, you're going to be able to make the most out of that opportunity.
Absolutely. And that's gold, man, because like people try to crap on Twitter because the stock price isn't the best and Twitter's dying and blah, blah. But I have gotten so much value out of Twitter, and I've made so many connections and built my LinkedIn profile just from Twitter. And so it's like, you know, yes, Snapchat is new, it's hot, and Twitter may not do the best on Wall Street, but do not underestimate Twitter. It is small but mighty.
I 100% agree with you there. It's my favorite network by far.
By far. So one last question, and we'll let you get back to your day, and I really appreciate your time. And it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, but I do want to take a moment just sort of set it up and set the stage for it, because in my personal opinion, and you know, you might think differently, but there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space with regards to career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a corporation or a brand or works at an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship or solopreneurs or anything like that, even though you could absolutely make the case that somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas are professionals because they operate at such a high level. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, like people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. So what ends up happening for a lot of folks, just using my own journey as an analog, is that you sort of meander the interwebs of Google for a while, but there's no guarantees there. You might land on lynda.com, Udemy, or Marketing Profs, or you might wind up doing Mary Kay in Legal Shield. Like, who knows, right? That can sort of shake out anyway. So what happens is that, you know, you meander the wilderness for a year or 10 or however long, and at some point you get serious. And at that point, you kind of have two options. You can do what I did, which is go back to school and get a degree in internet marketing. However, the cons to that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to do that. Plus, ooh, it's time consuming, because even though full sales degree program is accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. and 30 months in the digital marketing space is an eternity. A lot can change in that time.
No kidding.
So how most people educate themselves is via conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that it can be very expensive, because most of your top tier conferences, like a MozCon or inbound.org summit or something like that, they're going to be anywhere from $500 to $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, food, Uber, none of that. Just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you add all those things back in, you're looking at anywhere between $3,000 and $5,000 on a weekend. And then a lot of times there may be an upsell from the stage for an educational product or a mastermind or something like that, and those can be in excess of like $10,000. So even though in aggregate it's a lot cheaper and faster than going to school, you gotta have that money up front, because Russell Brunson from a ClickFunnels, he doesn't take financial aid, right? You gotta have Russell's money, yeah, or you're out. So there's gotta be something else. There's gotta be another way besides just either rolling the dice on Google, going to school and having to sell your firstborn child to the U.S. Department of Education, or going to a conference. So that's, now that I've rambled for a few minutes, that's, setting the stage for this last question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skills, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke. You have somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
All right. Well, I mean, we've definitely touched on Twitter. So that would be my first place to go, would be start whatever topic or whatever industry I want to try to get into. I want to start figuring out who some of those top people are that I need to follow in that industry. And though I don't put a whole lot of stock in those top X people in X industry lists, they can be a really good place to start. They're not an end all be all, but they are a way to find people who are still revered by at least someone in that industry, whether it's because they have personal connections with those people or those people have really big followings or, whatever the case may be. So watch for people who are on those lists or who talk about certain topics. You can do Twitter's advanced search and really drill down to people, even in, within a zip code, to say, hey, who are people locally here that talk about digital marketing? And you might be able to find different free events and networking events that are being held locally that some of those people may be talking about. So Twitter would definitely be my first step. I will plug Marketing Profs here, because Marketing Profs does have a lot of free educational content. They have 4 or 5 articles a day that come out that are all on marketing topics, and they have a monthly virtual conference and free seminars. I mean, you really have to figure out what is going to be, everybody has a different learning style. So what is going to be the most salient way to pick up this type of information for you? If you're someone that has the wherewithal to be able to focus in and, listen to webinars and seminars and take good notes and take those lessons and actually put them into action, great. But if you're a person who needs to be surrounded by other people that you can bounce ideas off of, try to find local meetups or try to find people that are local that are talking about the things that you're interested in, and reach out to them and say, hey, I'm really trying to get into the space. I'm really trying to understand whatever topic you're searching for. Can I take you out for a cup of coffee? Oh, I guess I can't take you out for a cup of coffee because coffee costs money. but first of all, and I know this again from working with Ann Hanley, never just reach out to somebody and say, hey, can I pick your brain? Because that's become such a cliche and overused statement for, hey, can I get information from you for free?
Right.
But start a conversation with people in the industry. Don't be most of them are really friendly, at least in the marketing world. Some of these people that have thousands to hundreds of thousands of followers are still very open to having real conversation because there's so much of a lack of that. So don't be afraid to be a genuine person and reach out to people that are influential in the industry and just have real conversations with them. Because I can tell you right now, I've gone to South by Southwest a couple of times, and where I get the most benefit is the networking happy hours, more so than any of the sessions. Because that's where you talk to people, that's where you make connections, and that's where you can get your foot in the door just by being a genuine human being.
Right. Awesome, man. This has been very illuminating, and I can't agree more with what you said. Twitter is your best friend, folks. Really, don't believe the hype. I mean, yeah, it could do better on the stock market, but Twitter's amazing. And what he said about folks being really friendly carries the genuine article as well. Very nice lady. Lori Thomas Ross, who wrote the foreword for our book, I reached out to her via Twitter and connected on LinkedIn, and she's nice as they come. So yeah, just talk to people and you'd be surprised who's willing to, you know, have those conversations. So Rob, man, I really appreciate your time. Where can people find you? What do you have in the works? Do you have any blogs or webinars? Just tell us how to get more Rob.
Well, thank you first for having me. This has been a lot of fun. I always love geeking out with fellow marketing nerds. So I appreciate the opportunity to chat with you here.
My pleasure.
You can find me on Twitter at Robzie, R-O-B-Z-I-E underscore, because there's been a squatter on Robzie for years, which is the bane of my social media existence.
How dare they?
Right? You can also find me on robzie.com, again, R-O-B-Z-I-E.com. That's where I'm picking back up on my blog, and I've shared a bunch of kind of my other ventures on there as well. So you can find any information about me on there. And like I said, Twitter is going to be the best place. I'd love to have more conversations with more people who are interested in what we do. So definitely find me there.
Awesome. Well, you heard him, folks. Definitely, definitely take this guy up on that offer. He's the genuine article, like I've said a billion times. He will respond to you. He will talk to you, as he's just demonstrated. And yeah, man, form those relationships. So, Rob, thanks again. Have an awesome day.
You too. Thank you.
Have you ever been paralyzed while doing research? You go to Google, you type in your search query, and seconds later, you're hit with millions, if not billions, of search results, and you can't make heads or tails out of any of them. Overwhelmed and afraid you'll make the wrong choice, you don't make any choice at all. Well, friends, you're not alone, but you needn't suffer in silence. The ability to make sense out of what you find online, and more importantly, call BS when you see it, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as what I've learned getting a degree in internet marketing, for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. One more time, bit.ly.com/DMD course. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's TEMB8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.